Whether in the context of real-world scientific speculation or just sci-fi world-building, envisioning a scenario in which humans travel to and colonize other planets requires tackling a number of logistical questions. What sort of technology would have to be employed to travel interplanetary or interstellar distances? How would a colony on another planet maintain contact with Earth despite conventional signals taking decades, centuries, or even millennia to cross the enormous gulfs of space between them? How would the human settlers generate the food, energy, and other resources they need to sustain the colony? And with regards to this latter question, if the planet being colonized already has a native biosphere, then an interesting follow-up question emerges. Could the humans harvest food from the local alien life forms? Would it be safe for humans to eat aliens? Of course, this then opens up a number of further questions concerning the ethics of interfering with alien ecosystems and the exploitation of pristine natural environments, but for the sake of speculation, let's not get into those for the time being, and instead purely focus on the science of whether or not humans could realistically survive on a diet of alien life forms. To begin with, in order for alien life to serve as an adequate food source for humans, it would have to provide all the various essential nutrients that the human body needs to keep functioning, which range from individual elements like hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon to large and complex macromolecules like proteins, carbohydrates, and fats. Starting off at the atomic level, many of the essential elements that Earth life needs are in the top 10 most common elements in the universe. So it's safe to say that these would be suitably abundant on most planets, while most of the remaining essential elements are minerals like calcium, phosphorus, potassium, sodium, magnesium, and various other trace minerals, which are all common constituents of the Earth's crust and become incorporated into the biosphere upon being taken up from the soil by plants and subsequently recycled through the food web. Not all planets will have sufficient quantities of these minerals, particularly gas giants, which don't have anything akin to a crust at all. So alien food of any nutritional value for humans would have to come from rocky planets with a similar chemical composition to Earth. Which isn't too much of an issue, since these sorts of planets would be the most suitable for human habitation anyway. Moving up to the molecular level, one molecule that all life as we know it needs is water. Even though it doesn't provide any caloric value, and therefore isn't usually considered a nutrient in the strictest sense, water is still required for many of the essential metabolic processes that occur in living organisms. Thankfully, water is statistically one of the most abundant molecules in the universe, which is corroborated by the presence of water on Mars, the moons of Jupiter and Saturn, in comets, and numerous other celestial bodies. Plus, water has a number of chemical properties that indicate that it might act as a universal solvent for life. So chances are good that on most rocky planets that are capable of supporting a biosphere, especially those that humans would have any hope of surviving on, water will be in no short supply. Besides water, the various other molecules that serve as essential nutrients include vitamins, or vital amines as they were originally called, as well as amino acids and fatty acids, which in turn serve as the building blocks of proteins and fats, respectively, which, along with carbohydrates, form the three classes of macronutrients. But one thing that all of these nutrients have in common is a structure based around carbon. Carbon is extremely versatile, capable of forming a greater number, variety, and stability of bonds than just about any other element, allowing it to form long chains, rings, and other shapes that serve as the chemical backbone for an incredibly diverse range of molecules, including almost all the molecules that comprise earthly biochemistry, which is why life on Earth is often said to be carbon-based. So, for alien life to serve as a source of these nutrients, it's going to have to be carbon-based as well. Fortunately, like we touched on earlier, carbon is one of the most common elements in the universe, and the fact that it so readily forms molecules of the complexity necessary for life also makes it the most likely candidate for the basis of alien biochemistry as well. When it comes to the specific types of carbon-based molecules that alien life might be composed of, things start getting a bit more speculative, since our current sample size of life in the universe is limited to Earth. However, amino acids, fatty acids, and certain vitamins like niacin have been detected in asteroids and in interstellar gas clouds, suggesting that these molecules might serve as common ingredients of life throughout the universe. But even if these basic chemicals prove to be the standard building blocks of all carbon-based life, Things start getting tricky once we consider the full range of molecules that might occur in alien biochemistry. Even though life on Earth is comprised of countless millions of different carbon-based molecules, this still only represents a tiny fraction of the potentially infinite number of carbon-based molecules that could theoretically exist, and there's no reason to think that the particular collection of molecules that Earth life uses will be universal or inevitable, being in large part an incidental quirk of how life on Earth happened to have evolved. In which case, there's no guarantee that all the same molecules, including those that Earth life uses as nutrients, will be present in alien life. A simple example of this comes into play with chirality, the property of some molecules to occur in left- and right-handed variants, each being a mirror image of the other. For reasons that aren't yet fully understood, Earth life uses only the left-handed variant for 19 of the 20 different amino acids, while biologically occurring sugars are almost exclusively right-handed. It's possible that there could be some underlying biochemical reason that life favors these chiralities, but equally, it could just be down to happenstance, in which case there would be nothing stopping alien life from using the opposite chirality for these molecules instead, a concept called mirror life. However, life forms on Earth have only evolved the necessary biochemical pathways to metabolize nutrients with the same chirality that they occur in earthly biochemistry. So if a human were to try subsisting on mirror life, or any other kind of life in which some types of molecules were of different chirality to Earth life, they may end up suffering from malnutrition. But beyond that, there's another factor we need to take into consideration. Although the essential nutrients humans need are present in the food they eat, they usually don't occur in their pure or unbound form, but instead as part of larger compounds that need to be broken down into their simpler components, which is accomplished using enzymes that each bind to a particular type of molecule or substrate and convert it into products that the body can use as nutrients. For example, dairy products contain the sugar lactose, which can't be absorbed by the human body directly, but can be broken down by the enzyme lactase into the simpler sugars glucose and galactose. So, in order for humans to gain any nutrition from eating an alien life form, they would need to have the enzymes necessary to break down the larger and more complex molecules in the alien food into simpler nutrients. And this is where we start running into some major problems. Most enzymes are extremely selective in which molecules they react with, only binding to specific sites on the substrate that have exactly the right shape, charge, and other chemical properties. And even the slightest variation in the substrate structure will prevent the enzyme from breaking it down. As a result of this specificity, a given species will only be able to metabolize molecules that it has the corresponding enzymes to cope with, which will be inherently limited to those molecules that occur in the foods that it specifically evolved to be able to digest. For example, some specialist herbivores have evolved mechanisms for generating enzymes to break down cellulose, the primary structural constituent of plant tissues, into glucose and other simple sugars, allowing them to gain energy from tough vegetation. Whereas for most other animals that haven't evolved similar adaptations, cellulose would offer little to no nutritional value. Likewise, if an Earth animal were to ingest an alien molecule that doesn't occur in the food sources that it's evolved to eat, let alone in Earth's biosphere at all, it's extremely unlikely that the animal would have the necessary enzymes to break down the molecule and metabolize it. So, the only way that humans would be able to derive nutrition from alien food would be if the alien biochemistry happened to make use of exactly the same types of molecules that occur in their typical diet on Earth. And given the bewildering range of organic molecules that could potentially occur in alien biochemistry, the odds of this would be vanishingly small. And to make matters worse, these indigestible alien molecules might have some adverse side effects. Going back to an earlier example, lactose can cause various digestive issues if the body can't produce sufficient amounts of lactase to break it down, such as in the case of lactose intolerance. And it's entirely possible that ingesting alien molecules could cause similar ailments, or potentially even have toxic effects. Despite being mirror images of each other, left- and right-handed variants of the same molecule can interact with biochemistry in wildly different ways, one of the most well-known examples being thalidomide, whose left-handed form acts as a mild sedative and helps to alleviate morning sickness, while the right-handed form can cause severe birth defects, so ingesting mirror life might come with a slew of comparably hazardous effects for Earth life. The specificity of metabolic pathways means that even very minor changes in a molecule's structure can drastically alter how the body reacts to it. While carbon and oxygen are both ubiquitous constituents of organic molecules, when triple bonded together they form carbon monoxide, which binds to the hemoglobin within blood cells and prevents it from transporting oxygen, causing asphyxiation and death in high enough concentrations. And carbon can be triple bonded to nitrogen to form cyanide ions, which happen to be the right shape to bind to and inhibit the enzyme cytochrome C oxidase, a crucial component of the mechanism underlying cellular respiration, without which the cell is incapable of generating energy and rapidly dies. But for a life form that uses different proteins for analogous tasks, these toxins wouldn't have the same effects and might even be a common component of their biochemistry, in which case it would be lethal for humans to ingest them. And those are only a few examples of the millions of potential incompatibilities that might exist between Earth and alien biochemistry that could have serious ramifications for human health. So, all in all, it looks like it would be highly unlikely that any alien life would be fit for human consumption. Even under absolutely ideal conditions, even on an Earth-like rocky planet with carbon-based biochemistry, eating the native life forms would come with a high risk of indigestion, malnutrition, poisoning, and, quite possibly, death. So, if you have a world-building project where humans, or any other species for that matter, travel to and interact with a different biosphere, and you're aiming to keep things scientifically plausible, then you'll have to consider how they contend with this constraint. They could simply bring food from their home world with them, or perhaps they could employ some method of processing the alien organic matter into a more edible form. Perhaps they could synthesize the necessary enzymes artificially, or they could exploit some of the native life forms to produce the enzymes for them, maybe making use of particular microbes for fermentation or some similar reaction, in much the same way that certain bacteria and yeasts are used to produce various foods on Earth. Or they could even genetically modify species from Earth to be capable of metabolizing the alien molecules, so that the colonists could still use the alien life to fertilize their crops and feed their livestock. Or, if realism isn't a priority for you, then you could always just apply some hand-waving, or just invoke straight-up magic. Like everything in world-building, how you tackle these sorts of constraints ultimately comes down to what the goals are for your project, but the simple act of considering them can often lead to more interesting results than you would have otherwise imagined. Thanks very much to Miles Wronkovich from the Let's Have a Booba podcast, and Logan Kersley from the Theory Neutral podcast and the blog Gleezer1337 for serving as consultants for this video. Chemistry has never been my forte, so it was very useful to get their feedback as I was writing the script to make sure everything made sense. Links to both of them in the description. And as always, a massive thanks to all the patrons for their continued support. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.